Welcome everyone to this month's session on spiritual questions answered, and the topic for tonight is spiritual emergencies. Okay, so I will not do an introduction. I shall assume most of you know who I am. All right, I'm Kat, the co-founder of CordyKet, and we are involved in all these spiritual and energy stuff since 2010. So the topic of tonight is spiritual emergencies. I get asked this quite often, like, you know, what are spiritual emergencies? Because we mentioned it in our Facebook, our websites, and our name cards, right? So spiritual emergencies is generally a term, all right, referring to, of course, emergencies of a spiritual nature, right? Emergencies of a spiritual nature, and that forms a part of the work that we do. So in general, some of the things that we do involve what kind of stuff incorporates spiritual emergencies. So general disturbances by evil spirits. Okay, so basically we will be covering what are spiritual emergencies, and how maybe lay people like you guys can deal with it, all right, and how we deal with such things. So one of the first type of spiritual emergencies is, of course, disturbance by evil spirits, and that includes possessions, all right. That includes possessions. If some of you have been in the have witnessed such events, all right, you will know it to be true, and it can be quite traumatic for those who witness. The other thing is, which is very common, is black magic. So whatever name you call it, from whichever country, as long as it's done using dark energies, dark methods, it may be based on rituals. Some people, you know, different regions, they may call it voodoo, or, well, different regions, they name it by different things. Usually a ritual, a spell is involved, and typically there are two aspects of it. Okay, so black magic, that's the first aspect, is usually energy, okay, dark energy. E for energy, all right. Oops. And it usually also comes with evil spirits. I've actually done a separate YouTube video on black magic. Right, if you guys want, you can just go to our channel, youtube.com/c/CordyKet. You should be able to find black magic. Under the we have a playlist called Spiritual Questions Answered. All right, so most of the topics are uploaded there. So these are the two common spiritual emergencies, right? They are clearly spiritual in nature, and it can be like emergency, like, wow, you know, if you ever seen a guy being possessed right in front of you, witnessed it, it's kind of very emergency, right? Black magic too, okay, and less common are those things that are of not an evil nature, right? These two are kind of like evil nature, or at least two are kind of dark nature. Pardon me. Well, and they can be things that are of energy in nature, purely energy, and not necessarily dark, okay? Not necessarily dark, okay? For example, it can be a very powerful kundalini that has gone wrong. So not necessarily dark nature, as in there will be evil spirits and black magic involved. Kundalini, what is kundalini? Kundalini is a, for those of you who know, You might have heard of this term, those who don't know, right? So what is it? So Kundalini is basically a very strong energy that is stored in the root chakra in the human body. Basically, it's at the bottom of the spine. Okay, around there, around the bottom of the spine. And there are many people in this world seeking spiritual powers, trying to have a Kundalini awakening. They try to awaken this power. And this power is supposed to, when it opens, it will travel up the spine. So from the bottom up the spine. And it can bring spiritual powers associated with it. And there are people who purposely do Kundalini meditations, Kundalini yoga, in the hopes of triggering a Kundalini awakening. And things can go wrong over there. Okay, we have had clients like that. So just to share with you what may go wrong. So we have a client from Shanghai, right? She was apparently learning some Kundalini yoga or something. And in a big class, and as she was doing this Kundalini yoga or meditation, something happened to her and she couldn't move, all right? And she just froze there, right? She froze there, and the teacher tried everything. The Kundalini teacher tried everything, but the Kundalini teacher just couldn't help her. She was just was stuck down there, I think in meditative pose, and just can't move. And from what she relayed to us, to Cordelia and me, is apparently because she was stuck there for so long, I think practically for a whole day, the Kundalini teacher gave up and had a nervous breakdown and just cried and left the room, and just because there was nothing that she could do. All right, and this client had something like that. It was like a Kundalini gone wrong. She just couldn't move. I don't know, she was stuck there for 1 or 2 days, right? But eventually it resolved itself. In fact, this lady, it happened in my session, or when I went to Shanghai to give a workshop, right? And it happened to her again, right? She actually came to Kuala Lumpur. Okay, we are based in Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia, for a healing session with Cordelia, whereby she told Cordelia the story. And when I traveled to Shanghai later to meet her, and I was conducting workshops, she attended my workshop, and then it happened to her right there at my workshop. So this lady already had a Kundalini awakened, and her Kundalini was quite strong. So when she did a group meditation with us, and then it happened to her, she got stuck and she couldn't move. And so I was like, oh, now it's my turn, right? And now it's my turn. And basically I tried to help her, and I resolved it within half an hour. And I thought half an hour wasn't that good, but to her it was already very good, because previously when it happened to her, nobody could help her. And to her, half an hour was very good, right? It was very good. I could help her, and after that she could move. Whereas to me, I thought that I could have done better than half an hour. But she had a very strong Kundalini thing that gone wrong, and the energies were so strong. She's so sensitive to energies that, she just froze. And so this is something that can go wrong. It's an emergency that's spiritual in nature, but nothing to do with the dark stuff. All right. And then the other thing that can go wrong, all right, is so one thing is Kundalini. So there are other kinds of energy awakenings. All right. So it can be spiritual, any kind of a spiritual awakening. Gone wrong. All right, gone wrong. So some people will have their chakras awakened. You know? Some people like to have their third eye chakras to be awakened, for example. Just to clarify, we don't do that. Okay, we teach a more holistic way of having your third eye open. Okay, we don't do that, even though we can. Okay, spiritual awakening. And another thing is what the Chinese call, the Chinese call 走火入魔.
走火入魔, I can't write it in Chinese, but the rumor, I would, you know, it was a rumor means being entered, being possessed by evil spirit. So it was covered under here already. The one that I want to mention is specifically energy becoming chaotic, okay? Chaotic energy. All right, chaotic energy. So, chaotic energy or energy outbursts. So all this energy that energy in nature. And this one usually is linked to trauma outbursts. All right, these are the few types. Now, what's energy up? Chaotic energy. So, chaotic energy can be like so it's 走火. All right, in Chinese, let me see whether I write it. Is it like this? 走火. Did I get it right? I think 走 is like this. Okay, maybe it means run fire. All right, so chaotic energy. Now, for example, we had one client who learned many types of different meditations, all right? Different types of meditation, and then mix and match and created her own, all right? Mix and match and created her own, and then could feel, because she was energy sensitive, could feel the energy inside her body, something wrong, all right? So that would qualify under this, like chaotic energy. Usually it's for people who, it typically happens to people who have different types of energy practices, and then they like to, you know, mix and match without having a strong foundation in energy. Strong foundation is in strong practice, strong understanding of energy, then this like thing happens. All right, then energy outbursts, trauma outbursts. So energy outbursts can be for people who typically it happens to people who are going through spiritual awakening, all right? When they awaken spiritual awakening, that usually it can be linked to Kundalini, okay? So it's not necessary. So these two are quite linked. And there is a lot of energy that is flowing in the person. And if the person undergoing this too, right, is not able to regulate himself or herself, regulate own energies, right? It can have a huge energy outburst and the person feels like, just uncontrollable, a lot of anger, headaches. So it is usually a form of this too. All right, but it's very clear there's energy flowing, okay? There's energy bursting through. Now, the fifth one that we have encountered is a trauma outburst or trauma release, however you want to see it. This can happen typically in like meditative sessions, all right? Or when people go for retreats, for long retreats, right? You go inwards, you do a lot of meditation and you don't know how to regulate your trauma. So some people have like PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder. And when you do meditation, meditation brings about a healing process, but for some people, they have severe trauma. All right, they have severe trauma, and the meditation releases it as a form of healing. But for some people, this healing, this release of the internal trauma, results in like the person reliving or re-experiencing the trauma, or there will be a huge, you know, typically energy and emotional outbursts together with the trauma. And then you have people like behaving like they're crazy, as if they're crazy during the meditation. Usually it happens, it can usually happens with group meditations that are bigger, All right. Or some people who are very into meditation and they do themselves and they can also experience something like this. Usually for people who have trauma. Okay. So, we have seen this happen. For example, I've joined a Vipassana meditation. Those of you who've done Vipassana, you know Vipassana is at least 10 days, 10 nights, right, at least. And you're supposed to stay silent and everything. It's pretty intensive, right? You are supposed to meditate up to like 10, 12 hours per day, depending on the centers. And I remember I saw a guy, right, while I was doing Vipassana, he had something like this, and he was just walking, you know, it was during break time, he was just walking, and all of a sudden, he dropped down on the floor, and he had fits, and there was, you know, some recollection of trauma and everything, and needed a lot of people to help him, and they, you know, they brought him to the sick bay area, something like that, and I don't remember seeing him for the group meditations after that. So a big traumatic outburst. And we also conduct retreats, and we have had cases where people with severe trauma, they reacted. And of course, Cordelia and I, we had to jump into action, and then we have to deal with the trauma outburst immediately. And it's not easy unless you are an energy healer, you know the stuff. Okay, so those people who do a lot of meditation, or if you conduct meditation retreats, and if you're experienced enough, you would have a chance to see all this. Okay, so these are the spiritual emergencies. Is to let people, you know, to share with you guys. Some of the stuff which we consider spiritual emergencies, and Edwin is asking, the spiritual emergencies include rescuing people who chanted the wrong mantra and gone wrong. Yes, that can happen also. For example, there are people, their mantras are not necessarily all positive, it can be negative, as in they go to the dark side. Alright, and some people dabble with the dark, and some people play with the Ouija board, you know, Ouija board. Right, and or spirit of a coin, those kind of things whereby you call spirits, so they encounter these type of things. So basically we help people deal with all these type of things. Now, one of the first things I will share with you is how you can possibly identify. Alright, how you can possibly identify. Okay, so one of the things you might consider is how to identify. For example, now when I'm talking about this, it doesn't mean that every case, you know, this works for every case. Okay, it doesn't mean that this works for every case. Okay, for example, in identifying of people who are possessed by evil spirits, sometimes it's just so obvious you don't even have to, you know, you have no doubt about it. But for example, a lot of real possession by evil spirits, when you look at the person, you know, the person is either in trance or just cannot hear or see you, don't recognize you. And if you look into the person's eyes, sometimes you can see that the person, whoever it is, your friend, your family, your loved one, is not there, and something else is there, right, inside him or her. Alright, so one of the ways is you look it in the eyes. Alright, so let me just write that. Now, but bear in mind, if you look in the eyes, you can see something really scary. So if you're not prepared to do it, please don't do it. Right? But usually just looking at the eyes of the person, you can tell. If you really look into it, you might see something. Alright, and then you really know that something is not your friend or family or loved one. Okay, so this works for certain types of dark spirits, not all. Okay, so for a lot of people, there are those are very high level sinister beings, high level evil spirits, whereby they affect people and people just look normal. They will pass this test. Okay, those are very high level ones. But for low-level dark beings and demons, the kind of evil spirits, usually, you know, this thing works. Another way is to play religious songs. That really have the energy, that really have the light energy, okay? So this kind of tricky, so what I'm trying to say is not all religious songs have this kind of light energy. Alright, not every religious songs have this kind of light energy. And some do. And when the some do, the light energy really has an effect when, especially when encountering this side, the dark types of spiritual emergencies. I can share with you all like my own experience. So when I started out, one of the things I was looking for, I started out reading energies, and I could tell which mantras or which prayer religious songs have very good religious light energy, right? And I would keep a collection of them, and I would play them because, you know, during my early years, dealing with all these spiritual emergency work, they can come in handy, and they can like, I would like to surround myself with all these positive light energies. And one of the songs, so just to share with everyone, so my background is Buddhism, all right? So one of my favorite songs is a Namo Amitabha song. So the Namo Amitabha is a mantra it's a Chinese version of a Namo Amitabha. So it's a version. So I was inclined to Buddhism, and I play this song, but I play all religions, right? But this particular song, I started out with it, and this song actually kind of saved me a few times. Now, so, and saved some of my clients too. Okay, so basically with this song, right, I always listen to it, I play and I listen to it. And there was one time, the first time I was helping a client, in fact, you know, the client had black magic, and I helped the client remove the black magic. And so after I helped the client remove black magic, I was just minding my own business, and I was listening to that Namo Amitabha song. And strangely, the Namo Amitabha song, because it's, you know, if you listen to the song over and over again, you know how it sounds, right? It started to sound like horrible. It sounded like as if they were like or something growling. And I was just shocked, and I don't know what's wrong with me. I kept playing the song. Instead of a nice song, I get the or something like monster growling. And I was like, what is happening, right? And I began to check myself, and I realized that I was being, someone was doing black magic at me, right? Someone was doing black magic at me, and the song helped me identify that I was being black magic. So very quickly, I did what I need to do. And it happened not once, right, but twice. So that song has a very special place for me, and I recommended it to a Buddhist client. And this Buddhist client, so she was involved, you know, there were people doing black magic on her. And so I told her about this song, you know, I helped remove her black magic, and just in case she gets something like that again. So she plays the song now and then. And there was once also she heard the same thing like me. Right, she listened to the song, and suddenly the song went go rah 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 or something like that. And then she called me, and true enough, you know, she had a black magic spell on her, and I helped her remove it. And after that, the song sounded fine. So what I'm trying to share with you all is, some of these songs, religious songs that really have the pure energy of light, it can have the kind of effect, all right, that lets you know something is going wrong, or right in the presence of someone who is being disturbed by evil spirits, these songs, right, will definitely affect them, right? They will react to the songs, to the songs or the prayers, right? So so if it's not this, so you need prayers. Another way of identifying is prayers by someone who is really spiritual or religious. Okay? By someone who is spiritual or religious. Must be a really good person. Person must be a pastor, a priest, or a monk. Sometimes even a really good person, right? A really good person can do it. All right, a very good person, kind-hearted and so on. And if the person is, you know, spiritual or religious and do some prayers, then you find that these things can react, and that's one way of identifying. Okay, so for the rest of the energy stuff, it's usually the person, all right, the person would know something is wrong. They would normally feel something. They would feel something is just off with them. Of course, this traumatic and energy outburst is kind of obvious. Even people surrounding, they can see that they're having some people would be so bad until it's a nervous breakdown. And usually it has nothing to do with the dark side. All right, nothing to do with the dark side. Okay, and mainly it's totally all on energy. All right. So this is a quick way of identifying. Another thing is, what can you guys do about it? Or what can normal people do about it? Things you can try, okay? What can you do? All right, when we need to talk about what can you do, first of all, we need to understand, we talk about this category first, all right? The dark side first. Now, firstly, I need to tell you, if there's someone is already being possessed by evil spirits to the point whereby you know, right, you can identify with these methods, right? Or some other things that I might have talked about in earlier videos, like ghosts. I think I talked a little bit about them in some of my earlier videos, like the one titled Ghosts, right? Then, if these people are already affected to the point whereby you can tell, then usually things have gone very bad for the victim. And typically, you need some kind of professional help. All right, professional or someone who really knows their work, all right, or spiritual help of that nature. But it doesn't mean that you cannot do anything, all right. It doesn't mean that you cannot do anything. So you can try certain things. So, but it's not easy to do that. So I will share with you all what you all can do now. Usually, by the time the person is possessed by evil spirits, it will not be a very straightforward and easy thing to just remove the evil spirit like that. And in my experience, right, depending on what type of evil spirits, in my experience, most of the time, the evil spirits do not come alone. Do not come alone. And because of that, usually just helping the main victim, the victim you can identify, is not good enough. It's not good enough. Usually for a good number or good percentage of my clients, what we're able to do good work is because we identify everyone who may be staying together who are also afflicted by evil spirits but have not gone to the point whereby they are clearly possessed. All right, and those stuff whereby people are clearly possessed to the point whereby it's very obvious their whole person is being controlled and moved by evil spirits, as in like what you see in the Hollywood movies. Those are only a subset of people, right, that clearly show possession like that. But there are many people who are technically possessed, whereby evil spirits are in them, following them, attached onto them, all right, and they don't show signs like that at all. So even though, yes, you see a person who's being possessed, right, and you're a family member, the chances are the evil spirits are not just with the person who is being very dramatically possessed, but the evil spirits are with other people in the house too, all right? And usually, the spirits, okay, so let's say you have a house. All right, and everyone's living in the house and you got one case of possession inside. Okay, usually what the spirits do is, the spirits come, they don't come alone, and they will create a dark dome of energy and cover the house. It's all darkness. For people who are clairvoyant, they will see that the house is shrouded in darkness or dark fog. And why do they do this? Alright, why do they do this? For example, the standard method, okay, when things go wrong, what can you do? The first thing is, of course, prayers, right? Prayers, mantra chanting. Everybody practically knows that. All right, most people practically knows that. But there are also the new age people who are, who would like to avoid religion. They will use, I would say, lesser methods. All right, there are some people who believe in using salt water, smudging, using smoke, right? Smudging, especially using like sage. Right, those of us in Asia, it's not so common, but in America, sage is a very nice plant. You burn it, it's a very nice minty kind of smell. It's a very cleansing effect. So a lot of people who are not into religion anymore, they will use these type of methods. Let me first of all share with you, these methods are inferior to these methods. All right, especially when you talk about prayers by someone with a spiritual or who are religious or a good person. All right, these are generally inferior. It can work for lesser spirits. Lesser spirits as in normal ghosts, lost souls, that kind of thing. Yeah, it can work. But if you have a really serious case, this salt, smudging, sage, salopanto, in Asia, you also have bathing with scented flowers and leaves, all right? Bathing. So bathing with flowers, whatever. What have you, okay, all these are lesser methods compared to this. Now, the thing is, even with this method, you find that a lot of times it doesn't work. Why it doesn't work? And some people are very surprised. And I'm like, you shouldn't be surprised, all right? You shouldn't be surprised at all. Think about it. If the evil spirits, right, evil spirits, they do their thing. Their thing is to disturb people, possess people, whatever. All right. And if everybody knows prayers and mantra chanting can stop them, and practically everyone knows some prayer or mantra, and they're so easily stopped, then in Malaysian language you say, then they cannot cari makan. Then they cannot earn a living, right? They cannot go about doing the kind of things that they need to do if they're so easily stopped by such a common method. All right, so what the dark spirits do, all right, usually the dark spirits do, they come in a group, they will make the house very dark energy. And usually if you're living with such a person who's been possessed, you find that everyone at home has very bad temper or depressed, you know, and the worst person, right, will exhibit a very dramatic kind of possession. Okay, so but you find that people living in a house, they're all unhappy, very angry, very depressed, that kind of thing, see all the time. And that's because the evil spirits will be, there'll be many evil spirits, and they will, you know, make the home with dark energies. If they like, they can even open a portal, a doorway somewhere inside the house, right, a portal that will help them go in between hell and whichever hell they come from, and to the home, if they like you guys very much, if they like the victims very much, right? If you want to know more about hell, I have done a video on hell again in YouTube. Okay, so they may even open a portal if they like the victims, the family of victims very much, right? They want to drain the energy of the person. Now, so first, so they do this to the house and to the people. All right, they do the same thing to the people. All right, so the people will be surrounded by dark energies. All right, such that when they pray, it's ineffective. So most people don't know how prayers work. Prayers work when you pray, your chakras are supposed to activate. Right, you're supposed to have some chakras. Seven of them, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. All right, and the chakras is supposed to light up and send the burst of energy, right? Send the burst of energy to help us connect with the divine that the mantras are linked to, right? To the divine deity that the mantras are linked to. That's the way mantras work, right? Mantras and prayers work, or specific prayers. But usually, when evil spirits come and get you, they will snuff out your light. They will snuff out your light and your chakras, right? Your light and chakras, and they will surround you with dark energy so that even if you pray or chant, it's not going to work. Right? They have their methods against the most commonly known method that people will employ against them. It only makes sense, right? They must have a method, otherwise, you know, otherwise there won't be so many cases. I mean, you guys probably don't know, but to us, you know, we see a lot of cases, and all these people will tell you, you know, they had a spiritual emergency, all the prayers stuff and all these things just doesn't work. All I tell you, it doesn't work. Usually, if the entities are powerful enough, it doesn't work. Now, in the future, what can you do? All right? That's why I want to explain, this is what's happening to the people. All right? Now, the black magic is similar, all right? Black magic is similar. Okay, so it will send dark energy. So probably the dark energy is going to be even worse, all right? And depends how the black magic energy, whether it's cast on the home, the person, the business, the office, right? So it's kind of similar, but the dark energy is even more powerful. It is being sent, all right? By the, I gotta mute you. All right. The black magic will specifically send dark energies to affect the people, and usually the people will have no chance. Once you have black magic, you have no chance for prayers to work. No chance at all. All right. And then it will send evil spirits along. So it's kind of similar, but in cases of black magic, the dark energy is very powerful. All right. Evil spirits, they have their own dark energy that they do. So some evil spirits also can do black magic. I had just had a client in Shanghai not too long, just last week. All right, in Shanghai, you know, Shanghai had a lockdown and he was so depressed and angry. He attracted some nasty little demon. The demon was a very powerful one, cast black magic on him and his family, and strange things started to happen. All right, some funny stuff started to happen, and he contacted me. All right, and I did the cleansing for him. So some evil spirits, they can cast black magic. Okay, what can you do? Firstly, you recognize that there's dark energy around you and probably at your home. So first thing is, prayers is not going to be easy. All right, especially if you're trying to do prayers in home, in your home, or office, or wherever the area is being affected. It's not going to be effective. So what you need to do is, you need to take your prayers and mantra, you need to You need to try to get other people to do it for you. All right. The more the people, the merrier, and preferably they are people who are, okay, spiritual, religious, or good people. Okay. This is where I encourage people who are like Christians or whatever religion you are, whereby there's a group congregation or group kind of thing going on. Get a group of people. All right. Go somewhere else. Don't stay in the house to have a prayer or chanting done. Or go to a temple, a place of worship. All right. Don't stay at home. Bring the person that you stand a better chance. If you stay at home, I can tell you probably over 90% of the time it's not going to have a good chance. But you can, for example, you can bring, unless you have bring a lot of, you know, like Christian, they say they bring the whole cell group, right? Or the, you know, the whole cell group to the house to pray. And then sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. If it doesn't work, it's because, you know, the house is also shrouded in dark energy. Even people who are not shrouded in dark energy, they go inside, the mantra or the prayer energy cannot leave the house to call whichever god or deity that you're trying to call. Do you get what I mean? Right? So even if you get a cell group, go to your house, but the house is shrouded in dark energy, you pray, no use, because your house is shrouded in dark energy. All right? So you're going to bring the person somewhere else. All right, so my recommendation, if you are church-going people, church is really good. All right, if you have mass on Saturday night, Sunday, bring the person to church. The whole congregation is there, everybody singing, and then you do it. All right, so of course, other religions have their own places of worship. You either need someone who's well versed in that, all right, or a group of people. The only thing is this, all right. When you bring the person out from the home, all right, you can save the person, but it doesn't solve the problem of this. It doesn't solve the problem. You get what I mean? And usually, like I said, more than one person is affected, because by the time this happens, it's usually everyone who's living together is affected. Why do I mention this? You know, I also have an uncle who volunteers at a temple. All right, who volunteers at the temple, and the temple involves doing work whereby they connect to the, it's a Buddhist temple. They connect to the Buddhas, and they also do things like spirit removal and everything. So he's one of the trainees there, and. He told me, right, based on his experience, right, it's not easy to help people who are possessed, because, right, people will bring the possessed person to the temple, but the evil spirits may not follow along. Yeah. Can you imagine, all right, you are talking in front of the possessed person, the evil spirits can hear that they're going to bring you, bring this victim, right, to the temple whereby the exorcism will be done. And if the evil spirit is smart, do you think the evil spirit will go along to get exorcised? No. All right. Or, you know, they'll just send one spirit as evil spirit as scapegoat and the rest will stay back. So it's not going to happen. Okay. So it's not going to happen. And he said, yeah, usually a lot of cases is like, because they work at the temple, so they find that it's not a long-term solution, all right? So they bring the person to the temple, they do, but the evil spirit is not always with the person, usually it's at home. So, you know, they have to ding-dong quite a number of times before they get things resolved, okay? So, but that's what you can do, okay? So you still need prayers, mantra, okay? And preferably by a group of people, okay? And you must leave the home, all right? Leave the home or the location. Because in an emergency, you don't know what to do, right? This is the first thing that you can do. You get a group of people who are good guys, okay? Bring the person out, pray for him, and you actually you stabilize the person, and then you get some experts in to deal with this type of cases. Normally, it will involve, you know, the main victim and the cleansing of the home, and maybe the other family members who are living together, and also including the black magic. All right. Now, okay. For all this energy type of stuff that has gone wrong, okay, what can you do? What can you do? Okay, it's not easy for normal people. All right, it's not easy for normal people. And sometimes it's so scary because you cannot tell whether it's an energy problem or it's something like evil spirit problem. Because the person who is having a trauma outburst will be like screaming and shouting and looking deranged, and you know, you're thinking, you know, you don't know it's zhou huo or ru mo. You don't know whether it's due to chaotic energy, trauma outburst, or is it due to being possessed. So of course the best thing is to call the experts, all right? So the next best thing is what you can do is you need to calm the person, all right? You need to calm the person, and all right? So you need to calm the person. In this case, and to calm the person, whoever is trying to do it, you yourself need to be calm. And that is not easy. All right? In the face of a screaming and, you know, probably moving a lot kind of person. So probably you have to pin the person down. All right? Pin the person, hold the person down, and just stay calm, focus on breathing. Focus on breathing, right? Slow, deep breaths. Calm down the person, slow, deep breath. Okay, you can, if the person can listen to you, all right, to think positive, think of happy moments. Think positive, all right? Positive. All right, think positive, think of happy moments. Think of light, visualize light within the body, within the mind if possible. So that is kind of like doing our light meditation. So have them visualize and feel good, think of light in the mind, in the heart, and hopefully it will work. All right, hopefully you given enough time, the person will calm down. Okay, of course for us who are into energy healing, we will have to sort out the energies and everything, and but that is for a later time. This is to advise you all, what can you all do if something happens? If you happen, you know, some of you, you know, are very into meditation, this happens. Now, if it happened to you, all right, I'm in general, I'm referring to third party helping the victims. All right, I'm referring to third party helping the victims. If you are the first party, the actual victim, usually there's nothing much you can do, because if you're already possessed by spirit, right? Some people, they have absolutely no conscious control of themselves. There are some people who tell me that they can actually see. They can still see through their eyes, but they realize they have lost control of their body, and when they're being possessed and something else is moving them. And they find it very hard to fight and respect the control of the body. And you can try that. All right. If you happen to be first person, you're being possessed, you can try that. Or within you, wherever you are that is being possessed, you are typically your presence is like at the back of the mind, all right, or somewhere in the heart. You need to fight back, and those of you who have learned our light meditation in Ichigo, if you try to do something like that, even though you are possessed, you can have a good chance of regaining yourself. All right, you need to fight it back. With our methods that we teach, right, practically for free light meditation in Ichigo, you can Or, I mean, the standard go back to prayers, but like I said, they are trying to, they have done this to you, and it's not easy. Right? It's not easy. But similarly, if you're a person that you're going through this, or you're going through this, you're actually, right, that means it's an energetic thing, you know, some energy chaos or whatever. Usually, if you can settle back, because a lot of it will come during meditation, all right, the awareness during meditation, or you are a meditation practitioner and you somehow trigger energies, right? Then you need to try and achieve meditative state. But if you're a victim, all right, you need to try and achieve meditative state. So you're going to put in a lot of effort to calm yourself down. So all this applies to calm yourself down, slow breathing, think positive, think about light. And of course, we have our methods of light meditation, Unity Qigong. Right? If you know it, it will easily help you get out of it. Right? Unity Qigong, especially, will help you sort out all these things. Yes, right? If you practice Unity Qigong, you should not be experiencing this thing. If you do enough Unity Qigong, there's no such thing. Right? It will sort itself out. All right, then Unity Qigong plus light meditation, even harder for these type of things to happen. All right, and of course, we also have a non-attachment meditation that takes everything up another level. Okay, so these are the kind of things that you can do. Feel free to ask your questions. I'll be going through your questions. You can use the chat function. If you would like to speak through the mic, right, please feel free to do so, bearing in mind that you will be recorded. So just let me take a look at some of the questions, run through them. So, Abby is asking, the spiritual emergency include rescuing people who chanted the wrong mantra and gone wrong with control? Can chanting of protective mantras protect one against black magic? Okay, can chanting of protective mantras protect one against black magic? Now, if you're trying to fight a dark practitioner, all right, using standard prayers and mantras, then right, Evan is Malaysian. If it's so easy to protect yourself from black magic, then the dark practitioner, the black magician, no need to cari makan already. All right, it may work for a low level dark practitioner, all right, and depending what kind of protective mantras you know, all right, depending what kind of protective mantras you know, but usually you don't know when the other person is going to strike, right? Typically they wait until you are sleeping, all right, when you, or it's during office hours when you're busy at work, you won't be chanting while you're doing work, right? And if you're not chanting, you're not protected, so, and they'll just do you, all right, depending how advanced. There are some really very advanced dark practitioners out there, right? They do you can watch my video on black magic and quite a lot more on that. Evan's asking, the rescuer who performed the spiritual emergencies need to neutralize the energy after rescuing the victim? Yes. All right. So I don't know about other practitioners, but for Infinity practitioners, right, Cordelia, myself, and those who are trained in Infinity healing, our modality of healing, we train people to do this work. Right, yes, they're supposed to deal with the evil spirits, the dark energies, and try to do as clean a job as possible. So these are some of the things that we teach our students, and now we're sharing with you guys, the public. Why is it that many people, right, many cases whereby they go for spiritual cleansings and they keep on ding-donging to and fro, you know, and it's like, you know, it never ends, because most of the practitioners, they focus on the main victim, but they forget all the other people around the person who are also affected. All right, and any one of you, quite a number of you are my clients, you will know, right? When I did the case for you, I didn't just do you. All right, I will check your house, I will check your family members that you stay with, or if the case comes from your office, right? I will also check your colleagues, right? And I do, you know, a very thorough job. And that's why it doesn't come back. Okay. People who fit or Sawan and hysteria can rescue using spiritual emergencies. Sawan fits some of it can be physical, right? It can be due to physical reason, not necessarily this reason. So, but if it's due to these reasons, then these type of things can work, right? So for us, it's like if we have such a client, we have to read the energy to see whether it's something like this. And if it's not, then we'll tell the person that no, actually it's a physiological reason. It could be brain damage, right? Some people could be prone to fits, and or it could be due to medication gone wrong, those kind of things, you know, and that is for the doctors to handle. Not us, we are energy doctors, not real doctors that heal the body. Okay, Jen is asking, any possibility of letting us know the good religious song mantra? What about mantra like Ratana and Metta? Those of you, if you are in the groups, right, I can send you that particular mantra. It was a YouTube. All right, I'll see whether I can find it and share it in the groups. All right. Ginny's asking, what about Om Mani Padme Hum and Ta Pei Chou? Om Mani Padme Hum and Ta Pei Chou. So there are many mantras. So Om Mani Padme Hum will invoke on Guan Yin. Now, no disrespect, okay? No disrespect to Guan Yin. But Guan Yin is not suited for fighting evil spirits in black magic. So Om Mani Padme Hum is not suitable. All right. Ta Pei Chou is a very long mantra. Let me put it this way, in an emergency, you want to do your Ta Pei Chou. Unless you are an expert in Ta Pei Chou, you probably cannot remember your Ta Pei Chou. Right? The Great Compassionate Mantra, of course, it's very long. You're going to get it wrong. You get it wrong, and the energy is not quite there. Alright? So, normally we recommend if you are into prayers, do something that's short, simple, and when you're panicking, you can still remember and do it. Alright, those very long mantras, I don't recommend it in a real emergency. Okay, so Kira is asking, will the evil spirit leave the person's body or will they just sort of go to sleep but still be there? If you're trying to handle it on yourself, the evil spirit will just leave the person, but the problem is not settled. It's not settled. It's just a temporary relief. You still need to get the experts in to deal with it, because unless you're able to deal with the evil spirits and banish it or something, all right? So for us, we will, depending on the evil spirits, all right? So those who belong to light, who are supposed to, you know, who are formerly lost souls, we will send them back to light, for example, or send them back to where they belong. That's how we deal with them, okay? So, but for normal people, what you can do all this, right? You do all this praise, you can only, at the most, help remove the evil spirit from attaching or, you know, taking it out of the person's body. But the person will still be very weak and will still be easily possessed again. All right. So actually, the way we do it, we have to, for us, okay, community people, myself, Cordelia, we remove the evil spirit, we return the light. You have to return the light to the aura, the chakras in the aura that will protect the person. Alright, and then we cleanse the whole home and all the family members who are affected. And we try to do some divine presence invocation. Right? I did another video, divine presence invocation. Right? Kai Guang, alright, the video is being in YouTube. Right? We do it to protect the people or the house. So we try to cover up, right? To make sure there is light that is protecting the victims and the home too. That is the way we do it. Okay, so for normal people, whatever you can do is only a temporary relief, especially against the evil spirits and black magic. So Evan says, sorry, wearing bright gemstone may not have enough power to counter the dark energies. Yes. Alright, so those of you who know my personal journey, I started out with crystals. Alright, and until today, I have lots of crystals because as I went along my path, which was helping people with problems, initially with crystals, I discovered that crystals and gemstones, they cannot help people with evil spirits and black magic. That's when I encountered Cordelia, alright, Cordelia who wrote this book, Possessed, From Darkness to Light. So basically, Cordelia was possessed and she was also a victim of black magic. She got out of it, right? And she had methods to deal with such things, and I learned from her, and I drop the crystal thing because those things just don't work. You know, and they're expensive, right? Gemstones and crystals are expensive. You know, our services are typically cheaper per person than buying crystals or gemstones. So, Evan asks, can modern scientific equipment able to detect dark fields surrounding the house, the person? Not that I know of. Not that I know of. Maybe some people have something like that. I have no idea. Okay. Some scientific equipment, like I've had clients whereby they could see the ghost, right, this year, through a normal CCTV that has infrared, and you know the paranormal investigators, those that go, you know, those who are very interested in hunting for ghosts and seeing ghosts, they go around with infrared goggles, infrared equipment. Some of the evil spirits that are in the infrared range can be detected using infrared equipment, but not all. Only a small range. Then some evil spirits happen to be in within the spectrum of energy. Then the infrared camera can see. And if it's a normal infrared, a CCTV with infrared camera, a normal camera plus infrared camera, usually the spirits look like shadows. Shadows, usually, the evil spirits, dark spirits. So, Edwin again, can playing powerful mantras loudly using CD player in the affected house feasible to lessen the dark field force? It depends who is more powerful. It depends who's more powerful. So I have people, you know, who know me, and they get all this play, all these spiritual songs that have light energy. But there are evil spirits that are so powerful that they can, if their power is high enough, so the dark is higher than the level of light, that they can send dark energy to even your CD player, to your CD, to your MP3 player, to your PC, right, to corrupt or taint the positive energies. It's just a matter of dark is more powerful or light is more powerful. Alright, so it depends on what kind of things you are encountering. They have their methods to deal with light. Okay, don't assume that they are like easy feed, no, I mean like easy meat, and you can just overcome them easily. John is asking, for people living in a condo adjacent to a family who's affected, i.e. the neighbors will be affected themselves. Meaning, will those people living with people with evil spirit in adjacent unit, will they be afflicted? Yes, possibly. Yes, possibly. Right? I have clients who know that their next door neighbor or the one opposite the hallway got something, and those things seem to cross over. It's quite normal. Alright, so there'll be some affliction coming across. Because like I said, I find that in a good number of cases, most of the evil spirits, they're not just one evil spirit, okay? It's not just one, right? Usually if it's like evil spirit with a demon, the demon will come with the henchmen, with a whole bunch of followers, alright? They're coming to feast on people's energy. So it's not just one. So, and it can spill over, right? There's a spillover effect. Again, Edwin, can powerful self-mind control cultivation protect against the dark force? I mean the rescue. Now, if you are possessed, in your very strong self-control, yes, you can stop yourself. Like when Cordelia was possessed, the demon inside her tried to get her to kill people or do something like that. And she had to fight to make sure that she don't grab a knife or do something like that. And we have encountered people over the years who were possessed before, all right, and they talk about it. They need to fight the urge to jump off the building, to kill people or you know, or to throw a stone onto the oncoming traffic in the cars that might cause a huge accident or something like that. So they. The evil spirits will possess and try to get them to do something bad, all right? And the good news is, you know, we are mostly based in Malaysia whereby, you know, people don't carry guns. Imagine if people carry guns and the evil spirit tells you to take a gun, shoot people, and you are a person who likes to play computer games whereby you go around shooting people and you just have that, you know, you just have that urge and you just can't help it. And then, you know, so mass shootings can happen that way too. Okay, so, but if you have strong mind and self-control, yes, you can fight against the entity. Okay, and I mean the rescuer needs
to cleanse himself?
Yeah, I mean, if you're the person you want to cleanse yourself, yeah, you can with a unity qigong and light meditation.
That's how Cordelia and I do it. I mean, we deal with these forces, and every now and then we get affected by something that's more powerful than us. So what methods do we have? We ourselves practice unity qigong and light meditation. Is unity qigong light meditation, non-attachment meditation, are our internal practices to help ourselves, to save ourselves, to save our disciples and infinity practitioners. But we are making it available to the public, all right, to the public. Nowadays, practically for free, right? We have like tomorrow we have a light meditation class, 9 p.m. Malaysian time. And we teach it just for free, donation basis. Okay, you like it, you make a donation to support us. So it works, all right? We have gotten into trouble before, but what we do? How we rescue ourselves? Unity qigong and light meditation. But you know, not many people believe in this kind of things, but if it happens to you and you've learned unity qigong and light meditation, keep doing it. I think there are a number of people here. Yeah, so some of you here are infinity practitioners or infinity students, right? I know you can vouch for that. So Jeannie is asking, can playing the mantra songs at home on a regular basis help as a general protection? Yeah, it can help as a general protection, like what I used to do. All right, better still, every day you do your unity qigong light meditation. It's actually even higher level than mantras. All right. So Jeannie said, I used to love listening to mantra songs. After some time, I find them being too loud and irritates me even when it wasn't on too loudly. Was that caused by evil spirits? I don't hear growling sound like you did. Yes, now, some of the evil spirits will, of course, want you to stop playing those songs. So they can try to affect you to make you not like those songs. All right? Not make you like those songs. The growling sound I heard was for the particular Namo Amitabha song, which I found was very good. I found the energies were very pure. You know, it was really good. And it, you know, it worked not just for me, for my clients too. All right? So, I have some affection, all right, and history with that Namo Amitabha song. I really like it very much. It saved my ass before. I'm very particular. I do energy reading. I find out which songs have very pure energies, and not all prayers, mantras, they have the same kind of light, right? Light, positive energy. I emphasize here, light energy. And we're asking, the ancestor guardian spirits can also help the afflicted house victims, right? Okay, now, ancestor guardian spirits are not necessarily of light. Alright? Ancestor guardian spirits are not necessarily of light. So, can it help? Yes, then it will be dark, quite dark. Alright? So, some people think, you know, so a lot of people have all these ancestor spirits and protecting them. And usually all these ancestor spirits are the spirits of your ancestors that didn't go back to light, they stay back. They stay back to try and protect the descendants. And they are not of light if they stay back. Alright? So dark can fight dark. But if like if you're a demon and your ancestor is not demon level, then you know, or stronger demon will win. All right, so it's not so clear. So a lot of people will rely on all this. For us, we are very clear. We are light workers. We stick with light, and we have people dark fight dark and can win. But you are trading one problem for another. Okay. So with that, I think I've answered pretty much every question. Okay. So no more questions. I hope I managed to share something with everyone. And give you a pause, you know, to think about what are the things that you should be practicing, especially on a daily basis. John is asking, Heart Sutra is not effective for dealing with spiritual emergencies. Let me put it this way, Heart Sutra is effective if you can remember it in an emergency. All right, so if you are not a person who's been doing your Heart Sutra all the time, and Heart Sutra is a very long sutra, okay, for the Buddhists. Heart Sutra is a long sutra. It's so difficult, right? And it's an emergency, right? You're being disturbed. the person, the victim is being disturbed, you are panicking, and you want to use a heart sutra or great, you know, Tapecho, the great compassionate sutra or whatever sutra you have in mind that is very long, I don't recommend it, because in an emergency, everything is, you know, everything is chaotic. You know, you're fighting to stay calm, and unless you have experience dealing with these things, you probably won't be calm, and you can't, usually in such a situation, you can't recall a very long prayer or sutra, all right? Unless you happen to have the book with you, or you go and Google it, and then you go and read, you know, that kind of thing, all right? So normally, those of you who are learning with us or whatever, we recommend short, simple ones. So John said, when can we chant mantra to fight against evil spirits? The louder we chant, the better.
I forgot. So the one more point, of course, all these things, the prayers, mantras, you need to do it aloud. Aloud. Not necessarily loud, but you need to vocalize it, okay? You need to vocalize it, you will have more effect, okay?
Jesus, so far, Namo Amitofa, Om Mani Padme Hum, help me. Yes, okay, yeah. So just, those are good, simple mantras, easy to remember. I mean, Chia say, Chan Namyo Heron Gekyo. So some people believe that one is pretty good. In my experience, not that effective. All right, not that effective, especially against this type of things. But you can do your belief, and if it works for you, then good. So far, I don't find it effective, right? Based on my energy readings and everything. Any other questions before we call it a night? Okay, so John and Evan say thanks. Evan usually have the most questions. Jenny said, can one chant Namo Amitabha go? Can one chant Nano Amiti go about 11 p.m.? Jenny, I don't get your question. Oh, Shirley has a... Jenny, can you please make a question clearer? Shirley, raise your hand. Yes, Shirley.
Okay, may I ask you, you say what chant is good then?
I recommend keep it very simple. Like if you're Buddhist, I recommend Namo Amitabha.
Okay, thank you so much.
Yeah, so if you're Buddhist, I recommend Namo Amitabha, because Amitabha is the highest Buddha in Buddhism. If you are Hindu, you can chant, all right? You can chant, for example, the Shiva mantra, if you know the correct one, or you chant Ganesha, Om Gam Ganapate Namaha, right? Ganesha mantra, those that you know, something that is simple, not too long, right? Those for Buddhists, the Heart Sutra, the Great Compassionate Mantra is really long, it's not easy. Okay, so most of the divine, they have not too long kind of mantras, right? Not something that are pages and pages long like the Heart Sutra and Great Compassion Mantra. Jenny is saying, I mean chant Namo Amitabha at 11 p.m. before bedtime. Yes, no problem. All right, you can chant Namo Amitabha anytime, right? Spiritual emergencies, the divine is not going to come with you. Oh, you're having a spiritual emergency at midnight. That is the witching hour and very powerful dark forces, and the divine can't help you. No such thing. All right, the divine is power, right? Is proper divine. They will come, right? They will come whenever they are called, when you chant their mantras. Providing
this didn't happen. All right, so you need to understand. So usually, if you're being the victim, you need to leave your house, and you try to go to the temple to chant. Okay,
all right. So you need to say depends on the strength of your faith for mantras.
All right, yeah. Eileen is right. So Eileen is have her own experiences, but your faith too is very strong. If your faith too is very strong, you can go past all this. So for the ADHD people, right, we train our faith, all right? We train our faith, we train to be able to do this even though when we're afflicted, right? Even though when we're afflicted, the dark side strikes first, right? That's why we have our practices like the Ichigo, like meditation. And with our faith, our chanting is actually more effective than it's more effective than normal religion practitioners. Thanks, Yilin, for reminding. So she is asking, Omitofo can or must chant Namo Omitofo? You must chant Namo Namo Amitofo. Namo Amitofo. You cannot take shortcut, all right? The mantra is written in that way. You chop it off, means you cut the energy off, that means it won't be effective, all right? Can use Le Si Chan. I don't know what you mean by Le Si Chan. Oh, Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sama Sambuddhasa. Okay, that one is Theravada. Theravada mantra, I find that it's not as effective as, for example, that is the Theravada mantra of Shakyamuni Buddha. You have the Sanskrit version, all right, or Tibetan version, which is Om Muni Muni Maha Muni Shakyamuni Yesoha. I find that the Tibetan or Sanskrit version, all right, the energies are stronger, purer, more effective than the Theravada version, which is Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhasa, right? That one, the Theravada version, in my experience, is less effective compared to the Tibetan version. Om Muni Muni Maha Muni Shakya Muni Yesoha. For those of you who are sensitive to energies, as I chant it, you might already be feeling the energies, right? Okay, you'll just compare. Okay, I'll do the Theravada version. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhasa. I'll do the Tibetan version. Om Muni Muni Maha Muni Shakya Muni Yesoha. All right. If you're sensitive to energies, you will feel it, right? There is a difference. Okay. All right. Thank you everyone for joining me. Will you give us the pure links? I will try and find the Namo Amitofo song, the YouTube link, see whether it's still there. Because when I listened to it last time, right, when I listened to it last time, it was, or I will just send it to the groups, lah. Okay, I'll find the recording, the file, I'll send it to the groups, right, which is our WhatsApp group, Telegram group, the Facebook group, and the WeChat group. All right. So thank you for having me. I hope you all benefited from this talk. If you feel like supporting, please feel free to make a donation. How to make a donation will be in the groups. Okay, for Facebook group is under the featured or announcement section. Others, I will send the instructions on how you can support us. All right. Thank you for having me. If you're interested, right, we'll be conducting light meditation tomorrow night. I hope to see you there too. Okay, see you. Good night. Goodbye.